My name is Jazz Bynum, and I am a dancer at the Boston Conservatory. Prior to my first semester at the Boston Conservatory, I tore my ACL. And so in creating a new schedule for me to begin my time here at the Boston Conservatory, I was entered into Alexander Technique to help me rehab after surgery.
First semester my freshman year, I got injured. I had stress fractures in my shin, so then I was introduced to Alexander Technique then.
I was dealing with chronic pain, and I went to go see a back doctor, and the back doctor said that I should try the Alexander Technique, and I was like, oh, really? Okay, I'll try anything.
We would love it if no student ever got injured when they were here, but that's not really realistic. They're working very hard, and it happens. But one of the things I say to students all the time when they get injured is, you may not know this now, but you will probably look back and think that this was an incredibly powerful learning experience and that it changed your dancing for the better. And a lot of that, I think, is because of the exposure they get to the Alexander Technique while they're injured and rehabbing.
The Boston Conservatory has an Alexander Technique program for injured dancers. I feel that it is so beneficial for dancers and for movers or anyone who uses their bodies.
As part of our curriculum, all of our sophomore students take a required Alexander Technique class for a full year. And I think for the students, that year is sort of revelatory. I think we are very lucky to have an incredible program in place here.
A big thing that it has done with students here at the Boston Conservatory and for myself is that it's been a safe haven and has maybe gotten rid of habits that we had before that might have led to these injuries already. And if not, then we come into dancing when we are recovering, and when we do start dancing again, we go into the dance studio with a new awareness and a new protection of ourselves.
The other huge thing that happens with the Alexander work is that people become more themselves. They come into themselves in a different way, and you see it in the dancing body. Is this deeper knowledge of who they are as a person and an ease with that.
It's changed the way I move, the way I listen to my body, the way I look and observe, the way I respond to my own thoughts and feelings. It's taught me to be so much more patient with myself and observant, and I think that's something that would benefit everybody.
We have what we call continuing studies or transitional class for students who are injured. And they take that class with Debbie Adams, actually. And they have the amazing opportunity when they're injured and not dancing to be in class while Debbie is training teachers. And so they get to work with these teacher trainees and Debbie herself and do some of the work of exploring what their habitual patterns are, thinking about maybe how those habitual patterns are not serving them. Is there a relationship there between the injuries that they've incurred and those patterns that they have? And starting to sort of reshape their dancing.
When we are injured, we can also come to you, which is always such a huge help. And I know that it's influenced a lot of dancers to move and think differently about movement. So why do you think it is so crucial for dancers to have Alexander Technique, especially at a college level?
When a dancer comes to the Boston Conservatory, clearly they're serious about dancing. And in the classes they took before they came to the conservatory, not everyone in the class may have been as serious as that. So there's an opportunity for all of the students in a dance class here to learn about the details of their coordination, about really learning how they interfere with the beautiful dancer they can be and help everybody relinquish those habits that get in the way. One of the things that happens when someone is injured is that they adopt compensation patterns for the injury, and they avoid putting weight on a foot that's been injured, or they will hold up an arm, you know, that's if there's been an injury through the hand or the arm. And so having people become more aware of what patterns they've adopted during the injury so that they don't hang on to those. I really do believe that every habit anybody has came about for a really good reason. And the question is whether it's still appropriate to use it. So once you've recovered from an injury, that's the time to re-examine those patterns and see, do I still want to do this, and what can I do instead? So that's one way that I think the technique, especially for the injured dancers, is really important here.
Because dancers deal with a lot of pain. And things are, you know, it's part of the journey of getting injured. It's really helpful and important to have those tools to help you to recover so that you don't come back into class too soon, which, you know, many times dancers do, but they have to have that experience and really understanding how you're designed. So the more you understand how you're designed, the better you're going to be able to use yourself and get the most out of your system.
It's been a lot easier to kind of get rid of pain with just saying to myself, like, relax, or like breathe into that spot, as opposed to automatically going to like ibuprofen, or like, you know, a lot of the pain and like tension that we get, we don't realize can be easily resolved just by relaxing and breathing and distributing whatever feeling that we have in those places.
The person who teaches that class, Shannon, typically films them at the start of the year and then films them again at the end of the year. And she likes to come and see me over the summer and show me some of these videotapes. And it's always just astonishing when we look at these tapes together, because there's so much change in the dancer physically.
It's just education. That, oh my gosh, I have how many bones in my feet? I've got 26 bones. Okay, so I've got all these joints in my feet. So there's, you know, 1,000 different ways to move my foot here. I have more flexibility than I think I do.
It's a new way of learning your body. It's not as analytical as anatomy and very specific to, you know, where things necessarily are. And I think it really gives dancers an actual opportunity to learn your body.
I really like table work. I feel like when you're laying on a surface and you can feel your whole body, it's a great place to tap into the wholeness of yourself. And I think it does make it easier to then explore just being and moving and being present when you are standing or in action or anything like that.
You make a good point about all the tactile information that you get on the table.
Yeah.
Because you have your whole body against that surface, and when you're upright, you often can't feel what's happening through your back and the back of your legs.
Definitely. Can we talk a little bit about chair work then? Because it's definitely different from table work, and I notice for me sometimes it's a little difficult when I do chair work. My back sometimes gets stiff, or I feel like I'm holding myself up with my back, and sometimes I feel like parts of my body work a little differently and you're grounded into the floor also.
Well, it's a perfect example of why table work is not Alexander technique per se, that once you're sitting upright, now you're dealing with balancing your system, right, in a gravitational field. And so then you start to notice, how do I usually do that? Do I do it in a way that I'm usually slumping? Do I kind of overextend myself and try to hold myself up? Mm-hmm. And so the chair work, just because you're upright in and of itself, will help you sort that out. But what's more important about chair work, and to me, a chair is just another activity. Mm-hmm. I like to do activity work more than anything.
Yeah.
But in a chair, the activity, the big activity is, how do I get from sitting in a chair to standing up?
Yeah.
And so you're provided with a stimulus, which is the standing, and you get to notice how you react to the stimulus. Mm-hmm. And there's that place of choice that you can react without stiffening your neck, so that your whole system can coordinate easily around the activity. I think Alexander had many principles, but the two that always stand out for me, one is what he called the primary control. I tend to call it the primary mechanism, which has to do with how your head is balanced on your spine. And people have a variety of ways that they do that.
Sure.
And Alexander's optimal balance allowed the spine to decompress so that there's a natural lengthening that happens throughout your whole spine when your head is balanced appropriately.
It's like, okay, this is where my ribs are, and it connects to my backspace this way. And being able to apply it to the actual movements that we're doing is great.
The freedom that they get when they do learn to free up and out, the mind-body connection, you know, that the thinking affects how we use ourselves.
It makes something as simple as doing a porte-bra. You realize that even in that, you know, how much work you don't really need to do it.
It makes me more aware and more conscious of myself and of my surroundings. Alexander Technique is very big about being present, which of course yoga speaks of and dance speaks of. The use of inhibition informs the way that I move and that I go about my day.
We teach the work verbally and through touch, right?
Yeah.
So that's, in teaching inhibition, that's where it can become important to use the hands to help guide somebody into a less familiar pattern of what they're up to.
Mm-hmm.
That little moment between stimulus and response where you get to intercept a habitual response and replace it with something new. Mm-hmm. And it's not really a stopping, it's a decision that's made in the moment. So I think of inhibition as a moving thing, but often when we're first learning about it, we stop people so that they can see themselves, notice how they're responding, and offer them a choice.
And then, of course, there's also the mind-body connection that a lot of Alexander teachers talk about that I think dancers are very attuned to also.
Mind-body connection, by using the language mind-body, I feel as though we've already split ourselves.
Definitely, yeah.
So the word that Alexander used was psychophysical unity. I think it's a little better, but I just like to think that we're a person. You know, we are a whole being, and I don't think we can really talk about our body or our mind mm-hmm. or any other part of us as a part. I just don't think we function that way.
Yeah.
So it's always an integration.
And fusing those two, not thinking that you have a mind, not thinking that you have a body, but that you are this one beautiful, singular, moving, breathing entity. Everything is connected. Nothing is fragmented or in pieces, which I think is so important for dancers to be able to feel connected.
In a way, it's kind of like an inner spiritual kind of experience.
Totally.
Yeah.
Well, one of the challenges you have as a dancer is that you take classes in groups mm-hmm. for the most part, and you have a nice big mirror where you get to see yourself, and you're all given some sort of instruction mm-hmm. and you look in the mirror and you try to do what you're told, right? And so from my perspective, there's an awful lot of effort being made from the outside in to make your system look the way it's supposed to in the mirror.
Yeah.
And if you're going to talk about being the whole person and embodying these emotional attributes you're talking about in order to express yourself, that's really something that comes from the inside out. So this is where I think Alexander's concept of inhibition can be very powerful.
Mm-hmm.
That when you're in a dance class and you're looking in the mirror, can you take a millisecond to connect with yourself?
Sure.
Not just your the image of yourself in the mirror next to your classmates, but your true self there on the inside mm-hmm. so that you can really embody what's being asked of you.
Yeah.
The other thing that it's really taught me, that just came to me, is I never realized how I was very much inside with my internal thinking, and I thought I had to always go and get the answers by closing my eyes and just meditating.
The other thing about the work is that it's very important not to get have your attention get narrowed inside your body, because the more you come in, the more your system will collapse, right?
Absolutely.
Your postural reflexes are designed to keep you safe in the world, so that by attending to yourself in the environment that you're in, those reflexes function more optimally.
Finding support in the room, you know, like right now, just connecting with you and hearing all the sounds that are going on, allowing that information outside of this room and outside on the street. It's really taught me to be present. And I never realized until I started doing this work that I was always either back in my head thinking about what had happened, how I was going to fix it, how I was going to make it right, or I was ahead, you know, into the future, like, I got to make this happen. It's just taught me how to be present in the moment. And this is it, right here. Do you know?
Having the Alexander Technique at school is so, so important. We can learn how to tap into moving in different ways. When you learn how to let go and not do these things that you have been doing for such a long time, you mentally and emotionally react to that release that you give yourself. It just feels right, and it just seems like it's the right thing to incorporate into these conservatory programs. I feel that it can only help and not hinder the way that we dance and that we think about movement and that we think about ourselves. It's such an empowering thing to be able to tap into our deepest selves. And I think that the Alexander technique really allows that.